Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Marketing, a Very Short Introduction by Kenneth Le Meunier-FitzHugh. Narrated by Mike Cooper. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Chapter 1. The Nature of Marketing. You'll probably already have a good idea as to what you think marketing is about. After all, marketing is all around us, and we're continuously bombarded by marketing messages at home, on our way to work, on holiday, and even when we're relaxing. We have discussions with friends about new advertisements and the latest promotions or products from our favourite brands. We're encouraged to write blogs and provide feedback to comparison sites. Our engagement with social media has moved us from being passive receivers of marketing messages to active participants who share opinions, thoughts, and feelings about the things that we consume. However, even though marketing outputs are familiar to us, we should beware of dismissing marketing as an activity solely to make people buy or just advertising. Marketing encompasses much more than that, as it covers a wide range of essential business activities to ensure that you can obtain the products and services that you want and need when and how you want them. Marketing has been described as about getting the right product to the right place with the right promotion and at the right price so that it will be purchased. However, a recent definition from the American Marketing Association suggests marketing is about communicating, delivering, and exchanging offerings that have value for customers, clients, partners, and society at large. Leading marketer Philip Kotler explained that in a saturated marketplace, it's more important than ever to anticipate and identify your customers' needs and wants, and to provide the value that satisfies them. Companies are desperately trying to stand out from the crowd, to grab our attention, and to gain our loyalty. The function of marketing is fundamentally an exchange process based on the premise that I have something you want and you have something I want, so let's do a deal. The assumption is that each party will gain value from the exchange. The job of the marketer is to make sure that the customer is aware of what is being offered and that the offer will align with what they value most, whether this is a product, service, or an idea, a charity or good cause. Potential buyers should be willing to engage in the exchange by providing money and/or the time that is required. This mutual exchange of value should generate customer satisfaction and future repeat exchanges, creating customer loyalty and extending a mutually beneficial supplier-customer relationship. Defining marketing. To understand some of the following discussions, we need to be clear about the difference between some key terms. Let us start with goods versus service and customer versus consumer. Goods are physical products that can be made, configured, shaped, and transported to market. Examples might include fast-moving consumer goods, FMCG, such as packaged foods, toiletries, and beverages that sell rapidly at a relatively low price, or white and brown goods such as fridges, freezers, televisions, and audio equipment. A service is an offer to the market that does not have a physical presence but provides value through interaction between the supplier and customer, such as consultancy, education, the leisure industry, and hairdressing. Services have been described as being intangible, perishable, variable, and inseparable from the provider. A haircut, gym class, or advice session has no independent physical existence, meaning it cannot be stored for later use. Each service event is perceived differently by the consumer and is inextricably linked to engagement with the supplier. One person's perfect haircut is another person's total disaster. Product is often used, including in this book, as an umbrella term for either a physical good or service, and is something that will provide value and/or satisfaction to its user or consumer in the marketplace. Many products purchased today will contain a combination of physical goods and service elements, and consequently lie somewhere between a physical good and a service offering. When going to a restaurant for a meal, you receive the physical goods of food and drinks prepared by chefs and delivered to you by waiters that are the service elements. Some products offered for sale are mainly physical goods, table salt or a bicycle, but they are usually delivered to the purchaser through services, such as a retail outlet or an online platform. Some product offers are nearer to pure service, for example, osteopathy, insurance, or education. These service examples, such as accommodation in hotels, also have important physical aspects, such as beds, facilities, such as gym or swimming pool, and peripheral goods, such as hotel toiletries. There has been a lot of discussion about the differences between a customer and a consumer. The customer is the person that purchases the goods or services from the producer or supplier. The consumer is the person who actually uses the product or engages with the service provided. The customer may also be the consumer, but often the customer is an intermediary, such as retail outlets, purchasers of raw materials, or franchise agents purchasing the right to use a brand name, for example, McDonald's franchisees. However, throughout this book, we intend to use the word customer to encompass both customers and consumers. Where did marketing come from? It has been argued that marketing is a concept that was developed from selling activities. As markets matured and competition between sellers of various products and services increased, and there was a need for organizations to promote their offer in order to have the edge over their competitors. Organizations often divide sales and marketing into two separate functional areas, with different personnel, responsibilities, and objectives. However, fundamentally, sales is a marketing activity and needs to be aligned with other marketing activities. Marketing, as a recognizable function today, is believed to have started with advertising in pamphlets in the 1700s, and it grew with the establishment of daily newspaper advertising in the early and mid-1800s. Billboard advertising became popular in the 1850s, and this really started the serious promotional campaigns that were responsible for raising awareness of specific products and brands. An early example of successful marketing was the use of bubbles to sell Pears soap in the late 19th century, which was initiated by Thomas James Barrett, the chairman of A&F Pears. A&F Pears was later to be purchased by Lever Brothers, which is now the multinational Unilever. Considered to be the world's first brand marketer, Barrett used a range of promotional tools, including testimonials, slogans, images, sales promotions, and gifts in order to boost sales of its distinctive soap products and also ensured that the product was widely available and competitively priced. The next big step in marketing activities occurred in the 1950s, when TV advertising offered new media options with wider scope and more immediacy. Advertising is defined as the bought and paid-for communications that are delivered through various media, such as TV, newspapers, and more recently, online platforms. This development was followed in the early 1960s by E. Jerome McCarthy's conceptualization of the marketing mix, promotion, price, place, and product, which has become the foundation of modern marketing strategy. The scope of marketing. Marketing is divided into a number of different subsets or applications that are focused on reaching different groups in the marketplace. The most common applications are consumer marketing, business-to-business, B2B marketing, service marketing, not-for-profit marketing, and international marketing. We're all consumers, which means that we use or experience the goods and services that we acquire. Consumer marketing, business-to-consumer, B2C, impinges on us every day in advertisements we see, direct mail, online and offline, and public relations messages we receive, sales promotions we engage with, and through pricing and delivery options for products. B2B marketing is aimed at engaging organizations with products that help them carry out their operations. B2B purchases are ultimately driven by customer demand for these products. The range of products covered is wide-ranging and includes items such as raw materials, capital goods, office supplies, consultancies, and products for resale. B2B marketing takes a different form from consumer marketing. We further explore B2B marketing later. Service marketing is concerned with marketing an intangible product rather than a physical good and can be either B2B or B2C. For example, marketing airtime providers for mobile phones to both businesses and consumers. The standard marketing strategy of the four P's, price, product, place and promotion, is insufficient to cover the intangible elements of the offer, which are expanded to include the additional P's of people, physical product and process. This extension to the marketing mix means that the different information required by service customers can be effectively communicated, such as the skills and expertise of the provider. For example, a consultancy would market the skills and expertise of their people, have effective online processes for delivering the service, and provide certificates, invoices, or other physical documentation to support their brand. International marketing requires a conceptual shift or change in focus from satisfying smaller national markets to reaching global markets. To achieve this, organizations such as Toyota, Coca-Cola, and Unilever need to make adjustments to their marketing efforts to meet the needs of customers living with different cultures, language, legal conditions, and factor conditions, such as infrastructure, natural resources, and the environment they are operating within. The globalization of markets has been a major challenge because although global organizations have considerable choice on where to operate and where to sell, they have to adapt to various environmental and political situations and trading agreements in each territory. Not-for-profit marketing is concerned with communicating the messages of those organizations that provide public goods and services, or those products that are produced for society's benefit, such as vaccines produced by pharmaceutical companies. In many cases, public services are provided by government departments and include items such as healthcare, public transportation, the library service, education, and marketing campaigns aimed at changing society's behavior, for example, adverts for reducing the consumption of alcohol or smoking. Another form of not-for-profit marketing is designed for charities to help them raise funds for important causes, such as supporting an area that is experiencing famine, preventing cruelty to children and animals, or repairing historic buildings. What is customer value? Peter Doyle, leading academic of marketing, described value as a subjective element based on the participant's feelings and perceptions. Consequently, value is a variable that is dependent on the point of view of the participants in the exchange. Value can take many forms, including a functional value, how the item can be used, monetary value, financial gain, social value, created in interaction, and psychological value, making people feel better. Customer perceived value is based on the comparison of goods or services to similar products in the market. To offer value, marketers need to be aware of their customers' needs, wants, and demands, as well as being able to present their offer in the most beneficial way. This focus on customer value has led to the development of the concept of co-creation of value, where the buyer and seller interact and cooperate to develop new products or find new uses for existing products. Value is created in the interaction between the two parties and can take many different forms, including knowledge exchange, identifying different uses for the product or service, increasing profitability or reducing costs, and creating a superior brand. The important part of co-creation of value is that it is developed through interactions between the parties, such as the buyer and seller. Architects, for example, will liaise with their customers when designing a building so that additional value is created through the exchange of ideas and information. Creating value through a market orientation. Competition within markets has increased exponentially over the past few decades. In response, many organizations have been adopting what is commonly called a market-orientated approach, which is where the organization as a whole focuses on meeting its customers' needs, allowing them to create greater customer value and satisfaction in order to attract and retain customers. An example of a market-orientated organization is the Apple Corporation, which is focused on delivering the best customer experience possible. Apple provide both goods and services in order to solve the challenges faced by society in communication and entertainment. Apple are totally focused on their customers and delivering what they want. They have created interactive retail spaces where they can meet their customers and have provided website platforms that offer customer support and spaces for customer learning. Apple have developed new ranges of software applications to increase customer interaction with their products, as well as continuously innovating new products and reinventing existing ones to meet customer evolving needs. In this way, Apple's market orientation approach has increased sales and created intensely loyal customers. Customers' needs, wants, and demands. It is necessary for organizations to understand their customers' needs, wants, and demands. The needs of society are the most urgent elements, and they relate to the things we need in order to survive and prosper. Consequently, businesses selling products that satisfy these needs are likely to experience consistent demand for their offer. Needs include obtaining items essential for survival, such as food, clothing, and shelter. But once these basic needs have been met, more intangible elements, such as feelings of belonging and affection, or the individual's need for recognition and self-expression, become prominent. Wants are less urgent than needs, as they are driven by our desires and immediate concerns for satisfaction, which change with different situations, fashion, and over time. You may want a digital tablet for entertainment purposes, but you may need one to carry out your work more effectively. Demand is created by the cumulative ability of consumers to satisfy their needs and wants through engagement and purchasing of specific goods and services. Demand may also be generated through social concerns, like the growing demand for reduced sugar in food, or employing models that are not all tall and size zero, but reflect the diversity in society. As a result, what customers want and demand change constantly. Keeping track of these changes is a primary function of marketing and is achieved through market research. The marketing mix. Since the 1960s, marketing has used the four P's of price, decisions concerning list pricing, discount pricing, and special offers, place, the direct or indirect channels to market where the products are sold, product, which is what the business offers for sale, and promotion, marketing communications, which includes advertising, public relations, direct selling, and sales promotions, to deliver its marketing objectives. A marketing mix for each customer group can be created by identifying how each element should be configured. However, the nature of marketing has changed in the last 20 years to include services, and the traditional four P's have been expanded to include another three P's of people, the human interaction accompanying the service delivery, physical evidence, non-human elements of the service encounter, such as equipment, furniture, and facilities, and process, sets of activities that result in the delivery of product benefits. Whatever type of product is being marketed, either services or goods, the function of marketing is to identify what each customer group wants and to develop a marketing mix that is built on the organization's strengths and conveys to the customer the value of what it is offering. These variables of the marketing mix may be combined in different ways to create the right recipe for a certain target group. This recipe is predicated on the organization's understanding of the target market's needs, wants, and demands. The product part of the marketing mix is how the specification of the actual goods or service can be designed or adjusted so that they meet the customer's needs. Once the design for the generic product is set in place, the marketing team can configure the product to meet the needs of different target customers. This does not necessarily mean that the basic or core product design is changed in substantial ways, but that the packaging and augmented features, such as warranties and color availability of the product or service, are adjusted to appeal to each target group. The brand name is a key part of the product element of the marketing mix, as it indicates the quality and value of the offer as a whole. The output of Heinz, a processed food manufacturer, is very similar to that of their competitors, but customers rely on the brand name of Heinz to indicate the superior quality and reliability of their products, which guides customers to make their selection. The place, sometimes known as channel, part of the marketing mix, refers to how the product or service is delivered to the market. Marketing should be able to identify where customers expect to find these types of products and under which conditions they are willing to purchase them. Some products will be primarily sold through intermediaries, such as retailers, while others may be sold directly to customers. Services are often provided directly from the supplier, for example, Microsoft products. Although services may be purchased through an intermediary, customers will often have to engage with the provider to experience the service. For instance, the customer purchases access to Microsoft software, but has to go onto the Microsoft website to download the software. Therefore, place includes all the various types of retail or wholesale situations, geographic regions, website platforms, or direct sales from which the item can be obtained. Promotions, now frequently called marketing communications, covers all the ways in which the product is brought to the attention of potential customers, including advertising, sales promotions, public relations, PR, sponsorship, direct marketing, on or offline, and personal selling. The development of website platforms has increased the opportunities for marketing to engage in promotions, but it is social media that has been the most transformational development for marketing promotions in terms of its effects on how the organization communicates online with potential customers. The development of mobile devices, such as smartphones and tablets powered by fourth or fifth generation 4G, 5G technology, and widespread public Wi-Fi have meant that a new and wholly flexible method of mass communication is available to all age groups. As a result, social media has changed promotions forever, providing sellers with the opportunity to permanently and continuously alter customer expectations. The price element of the marketing mix is the process of setting an appropriate price at which to market the product. The price should reflect the rarity and quality of the product being offered, but it cannot exceed what the market is willing to pay. This does not mean that marketers have total control over the price variable within the organization. Pricing, for example, is likely to be influenced by many factors, including the cost of production of goods and services. However, the marketing department is able to make adjustments within certain constraints so that the price reflects the value proposition. Further, the price of an offer does not only cover monetary aspects, but also the sacrifices in terms of time and effort required to obtain the desired items. Marketing services. The growth of service offers, such as entertainment, banking, personal services, and transportation, has meant that the marketing mix has expanded to the 7 P's to include people, physical evidence, and processes. Marketing services is challenging, as there are many more variables involved in their delivery and greater variety in the perceived quality of the offer. When you go to the theatre to watch a new production, you may have a very enjoyable experience, but the person next to you may not. This variation could be dependent on the individual's personal experience of obtaining the tickets and getting to the theatre, the process of attending, their interactions with the employees of the theatre, or even their prior knowledge or expectations of the skills of the actors, people, and their evaluation of the physical environment of the theatre and or quality of the programme. This clearly indicates why the marketing mix has been extended to 7 P's to cover the parts of the service offer that have a direct bearing on the customer's experience. The difficulty is that these 3 extra P's are less controllable than the original 4 P's. The people element will depend on many outside factors, such as training, the attitude of the service provider, and the skills that they possess. The people delivering the service may not actually be part of the selling organization.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.